That's okay.
Good morning, everybody. We'll be starting in a minute or so. Good to see so many of you. Okay, so I'll just open by with a few little technical things before handing over to Marco. Welcome everybody to this EuroGOOS Science Advisory Working Group webinar. Just to go over some technicalities, just so you all know, the webinar is being recorded. Please make sure your microphone is muted when you are not speaking. And when you are speaking, it's preferred if you have the camera on, if possible, so that it helps people to understand a little bit better. When we get to the discussion section, we'll be taking questions and an open discussion with everybody. But please use the raise hand function, which you should find somewhere at the bottom of your screen, and then the moderator will get to you. I think that's more or less it. So I will hand over to Marco, please.
Yes, Caroline, good morning, everyone. Now, today we will have a webinar from two of our colleagues, Patrick Gorgage from the Swedish Meteorological and Hydrological Institute from Swedish, Viviana Piermattei from the Global Coast Ocean Division of the Euro-Mediterranean Center for Climate Change, Riccardo Valentini, Professor Riccardo Valentini from Touche University and National Parco startup company. Now, I introduce the session. We will have a session that starts from the GOOS 2030 strategy regarding the three pillars, the three major pillars of the development in the next year. We are the low-cost sensors, the cost-effective platforms, and the low-cost data transmission systems. So we will speak about these topics. I remember every speaker has more or less 20, 25 minutes for the presentations, and after we will have a discussion, an open discussion for 5, 10 minutes for question and giving fact sheet or arguments that we want to face. At the end of the three presentation and the discussion regarding the presentation of Riccardo Valentini, he will close the webinars. We will discuss, depending the time, in a global vision, about 10 minutes. Then I will leave the speech to Lucico for next
steps.
Webinars, next in general, next webinar, in particular to the next webinar that we have in artificial intelligence and bio. I just want to remember, so for 1 minute of silence to remember the victims in Valencia. So please, everyone, close the microphone, and then we will stay 1 minute in silence for them. Okay, thanks. And I will leave the chair to Patrick that will with the team presentation. So please, Patrick, the chair is yours.
Thank you. Let's just start the sharing here. Let's see. Just let me know that you see everything there.
Yes.
It looks good.
Yes.
Yes.
Excellent. Good. So let's go. And you also see the presentation title here, Innovative Cost-Efficient Marine Observations. I just got an article actually in my mailbox. I just got it. It's from a place called Dialogue Earth. And it's called Scientists Are Becoming Ocean Hitchhikers to Fill Data Gaps. Now, this could be an alternative title to what I'm just about to present. It's really about the high cost of ocean observations that is really pushing scientists and others to look for alternative ways to observe the ocean in a more cost-efficient way. So this is what I'll be talking about. I give a little bit of an overview of what's going on here, and enjoy. Now we all know there's this massive need for more observations out there. We hear it from the Ocean Decade. We hear it from programs and actions under the Ocean Decade. The G7, IOC is one of them pushing for more observations. WMO, the same thing, WMO, that is moving much more closer to the ocean observations. So there's this massive need for more observations, but not necessarily people who are there to pay for them, right? This also goes for national level. In Sweden, where I'm based at the Swedish Meteorological and Hydrological Institute, we have the same kind of discussions. How do we get more ocean observations? Not recently, that report is getting a little bit old, but it's still a nice, I like to use one of the quotes in there in the mission Starfish, that they want by 2025, 20% of marine data to come from citizen science. 2025 is around the corner. We're in a bit of a hurry, but we're definitely moving in that direction where we can find more data coming from cost-efficient sensors and from citizen scientists. Luckily, we got this going already a couple of years ago, right, Lucy? You're on some of the pictures here. Because we had the feeling that there was a momentum going on. We initiated some workshops in various places actually around the world to try to bring the sensor developers of low-cost sensors together, just to create a kind of group and a momentum. So we set a number of workshops, ops, and this actually, it was all initiated by the Atlantus program, but then it took off and we have been doing these workshops together also with GOOS, the Global Ocean Observing System. We had a session at the Ocean Race and more. And we can just feel there's this big need and a need to get this coordinated in some kind of way. It all culminated earlier this year at the Oceanology International, where we brought the concept of cost-efficient sensors into oceanology that is more about the more expensive kind of sensors around. But we brought that in with a full-day session under EOS Technology Forum. Big success. Nice to show and get us into that room. Just to give you a flavor of what we're talking about when we talk about this kind of cost-efficient sensors, this is Anahita together with her colleague. They've been developing a micro vessel that you can put whatever kinds of sensors on. This is incredibly cool, and they're just about starting to sell the first micro vessels to the market. They're knocking on the right doors. They went straight to the satellite community and said, you need this for your satellite validations. You need our micro vessels. We put whatever sensors you want on board of them, and we start collecting data for you guys. And I've been in discussion with Anahita from the very beginning of the start. of ocean, that is the initiative, to also for them to start sharing their data to us so we can get hold of all this data and information. So we're setting that up at the moment, the data flows. Ocean, the initiative, they've been recognized already in The Guardian, in the BBC. They got the prize of the best innovation in the UK last year. So really getting this kind of attention that we need for this community. Another one that I'd like to show is the Open CTD, Andrew Toller's CTD. That is, you can buy it and you make it as like a Lego, or you buy them directly from the shelf. A CTD that costs you about roughly $400. This is what you get, and where the data accuracy is actually spot on in a recent paper. That's totally proven. Or Fernando, I'll show you that little thing because I always bring it along. It's this small little temperature logger that we have here. You know, Viviana, I always bring it along because I always want to show it off. It's a small little temperature logger. It's of roughly of the cost, about 60 euros for one of these. It logs temperature. Fernando and his team had deployed thousands of these all around the full Atlantic, collecting temperature data for biodiversity studies. This is just about to setting up a database to pull all that data into one place. And once this is done, and we, through Emonet, we are helping them to set this database up so we can just go in there and pull all that data and make it useful for more than the project that he's working with. And one more I want to mention here, this is quite recent, but it can have a massive impact. Scuba Schools International, they called me up and they informed me about, well, I'm a scuba diver, so I know if you go diving, you have a dive computer on. Every dive computer has a temperature sensor in it. And what they offered me was all the temperature, every temperature profile that they have in their system. So after a scuba dive, people upload their data through an app, and the data goes to a central database where it's all collected for all of their divers. So Scuba School International is similar to PADI. It's a big organization. And what they offered us is more than 10 million temperature profiles from all over the world that we're currently working on to try to ingest that and make that all available. So it's pretty massive, actually, this one. It's the world's biggest citizen science project. We launched it in February, but we're going to do a relaunch in January. And we're going to show this to the rest of the world that we are working with scuba divers on getting more ocean data in. And then I have to show you this one because this one is pretty spectacular. It's the Fishing Vessel Ocean Observing Network. It's a way that it's something that can have a massive impact at a very low cost compared to traditional methods. And I met Cooper van Vranken at a BOOS, a Baltic meeting 4.5 years ago. And he's a fisherman. He used to catch fish in Alaska. He had this idea, why don't we use fishing vessels as our observing platforms? And to put a CTD on the fishing net, meaning that a CTD would go with every catch and give us temperature profiles. And this is pretty amazing. It's so easy. So we start working, and a little bit later, we've been taking off boxes to turn this in really to a global observing network. It's the data that's collected is fully automatic. It goes to a cloud database. And from there, we can actually take that straight into data aggregators in Europe and around the world. The cool thing, it's very complementary to Argo. So on this these pictures, you can see two examples. This one from northeastern US of the number of Argo floats in the US and also in New Zealand, and where there are fishing activities going on in the same areas and where we are already collecting data from these fishing vessels. So it's very close to the coast where we are seriously lacking a lot of observations. I would say that the land-sea interface is probably the the hottest area at the moment to get more observations from. And in New Zealand, they decided the New Zealand government were considering how to expand their ocean observing network because they knew it was poor. And they also knew it was needed to get more observations in for to make their operational models better. So then what they did was they decided on from governmental level to equip 250 fishing vessels with CTDs, which made New Zealand into the most observed area in the world when it gets to temperature profiles. And you can just see the kind of massive increase that we managed to get through the Moana project by making this happen. All this data, again, fully automated, goes straight to the to support the forecast to New Zealand, and has made a massive difference in the outcome, in the model outcome, but also from the observation point of view. This is a success story. It's pretty massive. And we're trying to get other countries to join the same kind of movement around the world, get the governments to understand that this is a really cost-efficient way to get much more observations in. So it's cheap. And it's also because that's the biggest cost in making often to make observations is the platform and the deployment. Now we already have that here. We have the platform and the deployment, you just put a sensor on board and off it goes. A kind of comparison about the costs from a traditional mooring glider Argo and what the FON, the Fishing Vessel Ocean Observing Network, how much it costs for a temperature profile per day. So it's really decreasing the cost pretty massively. It's not about replacing anything. It's about complementing the observing, the already existing observing network. And the accuracy is just spot on. It's up there with the gliders and the moorings and the Argos and so on. We set up machine-to-machine connections. So data is going to AirDaps and to the GTS, going to Copernicus and EpoNets. And the fisheries guys are involved in it. So they are keen on to get these observations for their purposes. And they are willing to share the data to us. So it's really a very, very nice kind of initiative. And I'm showing this one as an example also for other potential networks that we can start building. But this is just one that's been taking off every little box. So we had a meeting 10 days ago, where the first time ever we gathered the whole global community as it looks today in Sydney, Australia, to talk about the next steps. We managed to get FON endorsed by GOOS as an emerging network. So we are there together with gliders and other networks under GOOS. It's also an action under the Coast Predict program under the UN decade. And it's really interdisciplinary. So it's oceanography, it's fishery science, it's startups and so on. So it's pretty exciting what we are doing here. And it's an ever increasing number of people who want to join what we are doing here. We have a very, I won't say it officially, but I'll still say it, but we have a kind of goal to reach up to 20,000 fishing vessels that are collecting data in a not too far away future. We're just gonna, it's a game change. It's really totally a game change. And in the end, what we want is that we want for any initiative similar to this one and citizen science initiatives and other similar kind of cost efficiency initiatives, we need the data to be fair so we can set up that seamless data flow. We need to help them. We need to guide them in the process to make the data fair. I think you all know what FAIR is: findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable, because we want that data to be made available to the rest of the world. This can be through whatever data aggregators we have out there. Here a snapshot from the EmoNet portal, where we actually have fishing vessel data, and we have other data from cost-efficient sensors already in EmoNet. So if we just look a little bit on some of the strength, I probably already mentioned many of them, but this is really an emerging technology. It's really, there's a massive momentum going on. It can really be a key tool to fill data gaps in the existing and also in the more local monitoring networks. It supplements existing monitoring networks. It's not there to take over anyway. It's just complementing the existing networks, mainly in the shelf and coastal seas. But this is also where we have some of the biggest needs in the coastal areas. They show a massive potential for advancing citizen science. And just think about it with the mobile phones. We have 5 billion smartphones around. Some of these, you can already now collect data, or you can use apps where you can collect ocean data from. Let's make use of all this. And it contributes really to the kind of globalizing the contributions from scientists and citizens to fill observation and data gaps. It also comes with challenges. I'm just saying some of them. I'm sure, Viviana, you're going to have more stuff to put in the good and bad here. There are some technical trade-offs. Potentially, it could be, you know, it's lower cost. May not necessarily be that also you're touching a bit on the quality and the sensitivity of lower concentrations and so on. But you get a lot of data. You get big amounts of it. There are many initiatives generating data, not necessarily sharing. That's why it's important that we start guiding these initiatives on how to do it. So we need to develop data management processes and to teach people what FAIR is about, really. And it would be good if these sensors are co-located with reference stations, because that would also give much more confidence for scientists to use that data. But we're not. It's a bit of a game change now. We don't necessarily have to chase the decimals anymore in the data. We need to know what the quality is instead. If we know the quality, it's up to the users to decide on if they want to use this or not. So some next steps that we're looking at. We need to understand this, the cost-effective sensor landscape and the needs. What sensors exist? Who are the developers? We need a more widespread acceptance of, let's call it, well, I don't like low cost, but cost efficient technology. And it would be great if we had a centralized marketplace, like a website, to create a database, a directory of low cost technology that providers give opportunity for test beds to develop these best practices and standards, and create methods so the data interoperability. The good thing is it's already happening. So we have a couple of initiatives. We are working together with US colleagues in Synchro. Synchro is an Ocean Decade Action, and they're doing very similar on the US side and with the Lancelot project here in Europe. Very short about Lancelot, because it's a bit of a, it's a new kind of way of thinking. Lancelot is really about the land-sea interface. We are closing data gaps in the land-sea interface, and we're doing that with the help of low-cost technologies and citizen science. This is one of the things we do in Lancelot. We do this together with the three RIs, Danubius, Jericho, and ICOS, and trying to get these three RIs to share data in a common way, FAIR data. More data into the coastal zones to feed eMonet, Copernicus, Edito, and so on. So we set up a number of integration labs around Europe where we will be deploying low-cost sensors to fill these data gaps. And not all of them, but many of them, we're just in the process of buying these sensors and starting to deploy them to address some key societal challenges that you can see up there to the right. This is what we're going to address there. Very exciting project, a lot of fun. But we're going beyond this. Lancelot started just, what is it now? It's 10 months ago or so. So it's early days, but keep an eye on that one, because this is going to, it's very exciting. And the next steps beyond that is that we set up something that we call SCOOP. Solutions for cost-effective ocean observations. This is also an action under the Ocean Decade and under the program Coast Predict, where we really want to provide this focal point of coordination, coordinating sensors and sensor developers, and giving our community, the research community, the tools to find, and also for citizen scientists to a place where you can find this kind of information, to build a network, to create a catalog of sensors that we already actually have in Maiden and Lancelot. We have a catalog of 70 plus sensors in there for something like 40 sensor developers. So develop a framework to create the data interoperability, look at the standards. There, this is what I've been saying before. And there's some of them down there, some of the logos, but we have something like 50 different organizations that are supporting Scoop at the moment. So it's ever, ever increasing what we're doing there, pulling all this together into one kind of marketplace to make the connections between sensor developers and the scientists. Well, one more thing on Lancelot. I'm sure you guys think this is pretty cool. I hope you know some sensor developers that you know about that we might not know about, or citizen science initiatives. If you have that, if you know about, if you're aware of any of these and you want to share that information with us, that would be fantastic. Then we can add them to our catalog, we can add them to our list, and we can create this kind of global information place for this kind of information. And that's all for me.
Thank you very much, Patrick. Before to ask if there is some question, there is a chat question from Jasmine Hutler. There is, are you aware of the project Blue Dot? It's done by a German scientist together with Paddy.
Yes, I am, because they also reached out to me. So I'm aware of that one, and they are seeking collaboration opportunities. So thanks for that one. And thanks for that, because I actually needed that reminder. So perfect. I'll go back to them and contact them again. I think they're partly based in Australia too, if I remember right.
Okay, perfect. And there are questions? Other questions?
I think Holger.
Yeah, Holger, you have your hand up, Holger.
I have my hand up, yeah, thanks. Very nice overview, Patrick. I was wondering, you didn't talk much about finances beyond the fact that the sensors are obviously cheaper than what we regularly use. And I'm wondering, do you foresee that there are other financing streams one could tap into? I mean, for example, if I look at the map that you had for your fisheries sensors, and I saw you had a one dot in West Africa, and I'm just wondering, is this a new way of collaborating with local governments? If you could say a few words about finances, that would be nice.
You're spot on here. And this has been one of the challenges with the fishing vessel network. One of the main discussions we had when we met here then a couple of weeks ago was about seeking alternative finance routes and where to go. We just simply have to start relying on EU funding to support this kind of action. So we have to find other routes. What we did during that week was really to identify potential alternative finance routes. So we have that, we have listed them, and we are just about to make an evaluation of which ones are the right ones to target for this particular activity. It could be foundations, for instance. They have a lot of that going on, much more in the United States than we have in Europe. There's a lot of funding around there, and there's a big interest as well. But for us as typical oceanographers, we need to figure them out first, and we need to know where to go. I'll know more within like a month on where that particular community is going and the kind of where we're going to be heading to look for finances, but it's not the usual kind of routes that we go. We're looking for a new way of thinking with this one, and very much down on local governments, because we already tried this out in some African countries, and that's in dialogue directly with the governments that we do that. So it makes it very strong if you can make that connection and make that one early. So I'll stop there, but I'll have more on this. Give me a little while and we'll figure it out for that one. That might be a model for other ones to follow in the future.
Marcel?
Thanks, Marco. Patrick, one question to the data quality. Do you perform any data quality checks, or do we really take the data as they are?
If the goal is to get this data ingested into eMonad, we need to have a known quality, and that's all we need. A known quality makes it for the end user to make the decision if they want to use that or not. It depends also on how advanced these the different communities are. The fishing vessel guys, they do the QA. So that's a given, because it's very high level and the sensors are very advanced and the whole data management system is just spot on. Other ones for citizens, some of the citizen science initiatives, they won't do that. So either we decide on to do it for them, or we just provide the data as is, but with a known quality.
Other questions? If nobody has another question, I have just one for you, Patrick. For you, which kind of variables, biological variables mainly, that now are not present in low-cost sensors or cost-effective sensors, it's possible to improve primarily and in secondary way? So which is the direction for you to address to arrive to complete an overview in the low cost or cost effective measurements for the biological or ecological compact?
Viviana, Lucy, help me out here, but it's really the physics is the usual one that is it's there, it's present. It's moving towards biology, where it gets more complicated because it's really difficult to lower the cost there. But I think Viviana has, maybe you have an update on that one. I think maybe you have something in the pipeline. But that's the tendency. Is the interesting thing is, when I talk to these sensor developers, their biggest challenge was to know where to go to meet the people who are going to use their sensors. So, for instance, researchers, they didn't have a place to go. And now we're offering them the place. And in dialogue with each and every sensor developer I've been talking to, they're so open to adapt to our needs. So things that we want, we let them know, and they would adapt because we are providing them the marketplace. So we have a little bit of a good opportunity here to influence on where we want it to go in the future, and to work directly together with the sensor developers. A Swedish developer who has a very cool little sensor. You put it on your fishing rod when you go out sport fishing, and actually you get a temperature and a salinity profile. I told these guys that their market is very limited. They're only aiming for sport fishermen. And I said, if you just tweak this sensor a bit to look in this kind of way, we can use it for multiple purposes. And they got totally excited about it. So willing to adapt to our needs and to develop their sensors to fill those needs. But Vivi, maybe you have something more.
I will try to show you.
Oh, okay.
So.
Good. Cool. Yes. I thought so. Yeah.
Yes. And I hope someone will ask about this, because yes, I think it's a big challenge, and because most of the low cost technologies and citizen science measurement are related to physical variables. For yeah. Sure, but we have to improve the biogeochemistry and the biological variables. But as you say, it's important to begin, and yes, the quality control is very important. I will show you something, but We have to take data because we need data to understand the system, to feed the forecasting models, and to try to have data to have knowledge about the marine environment. So we have to begin somewhere. We for sure the technological advances are improving and are working also on the more on the biological and biogeochemistry variables for sure.
So we're and it's early days with all this. I've only been in here looking at this kind of technologies for the past couple of years, but during these years the interest is simply exploding. And new startups all over the place trying to meet the needs of the ocean community. So it's a perfect time to start this and get it going. And in particular, if we can do that in a dialogue with the sensor developers, we can reach some pretty nice stuff further down the road.
Thank you, Bart. Thank you, Patrick. You spoke about accuracy and quality in your presentation. Do you include also the sensors drift in this assessment of the sensors, or the quality drift of the sensors is a two-phase at now?
We haven't got that far yet. It's like I said, it's very early days. So we're exploring this whole area a little bit. But you probably have more on that, Viviana. I would think that you have some comments on that. But we're not really looking at that at the moment. We know there's a drift in some of these sensors around, but we haven't addressed it as such yet. It's more to connect to the communities and try to get the first kind of data out. So we have a showcase and we can prove something. And then we'll tick off every little detail one by one further down the road.
Thank you very much. If there are not other questions.
There was a comment.
There is a comment of Lucy.
Yeah, when it comes to sediment transfer, erosion, turbidity, you can also get very interesting local solutions. So that's a comment. Let's not forget that.
No. Maybe I should have shown the whole sensor list that we have in Lancelot with this 70 plus sensors and ever increasing. I get emails every week at least of new sensor developers who want to have their sensors included in this catalog of sensors. There's a lot going on there, and we'll make that catalog live pretty soon. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's cool, isn't it?
Thank you.
And also just to say that we are collaborating with our colleagues in the United States on this, because we thought it's better to try to build something with a more global thinking than we build something in Europe, they build something in the US, Australia is building something too, and we later on want to merge. Let's collaborate directly. Let's collaborate from now on instead. They collect this information. We do it. Australians do it. People in Asia do it. And we build a common global database or information place for this stuff. Sounds very EuroGoosy, doesn't it? I think so.
Other questions? I have a general observation, but I would like to do at the end of all the presentation, because I think is a common discussion topic for the three speakers. And if there are no other questions, I don't see other questions. So, or chat. Oh, there is Eric Machu. It would be nice to also involve academic world and engineering school for southern countries. Patrick, for you.
Southern countries. What do you mean by southern countries?
I think from
Africa.
South America and
Africa.
Viviana, we can talk about Coast Predict and Global Coast, the action under the decade program Coast Predict, where this is exactly the goal, is to reach out to these communities much, much more than we do today. So a lot of the things we're talking about here will feed in to Coast Predict and global coast action under Coast Predict to enable exactly that. Again, it's pretty early days. Give us a little while and all this will happen.
Yeah. It's one of the goals of the UN decade. Yeah. So the sustainability of the observing systems to do this. And we know very well what is going to be moved for this, because we know that our Horizon Call and many, many projects are trying to do this, to try to share the technologies and also with the southern countries. And we need low cost and citizen science applications and initiatives to do this, because for sure they will add the capability to measure this kind of data acquisition. Holger, yeah, who was involved in the call. Yes.
Just to add an answer for Eric, there are also several programs by Partnership for Ocean Global Observation.
Yeah.
And one is the Open Mode Initiative that is open, clear, so clear the significance of open, Mode Marine Observatory System. And the other one now is another impulse regarding the sea level sharing technology. So, and there are also courses with the Wegener Institute and another initiative that involve southern countries.
Yeah, we have POGO on the radar. We have had some initial discussions with POGO. So we're trying to make those connections to the relevant groups we can get.
So I would like to go to the next presentation now.
No, there is a question by Holger.
Sorry to interrupt things here again. this is probably coming out of complete ignorance of the subject of low-cost sensors. Is there something out there that can be used to determine bathymetry? I mean, I know that you talked about paddy divers and temperature profiles and things like that, but is there something that can go more directly into bathymetry? Because I mean, that is one of the things that I noted, that a lot of the countries in the global south have issues setting up models or digital twins or whatever, because they just don't have information on that. And I think this would also be something that would be tremendously helpful in the field. Thanks.
Viviana, are you aware of any of that? I know that the initiative I showed you, Ocean, they also collect bathymetry data, but that's the only one I'm aware of.
I don't know if Viviana, you have in your presentation some answer that
No, for the bathymetry, no, we don't work on this kind of parameters on the acoustic, because we work more on the physical, but also on the biooptical parameters. I heard something, but I had to deepen something related always on the fishery. Is related to the knowledge of some acoustic measurements for the nets, but they apply to know the volume of fishes inside the net. So it's something of acoustic. I'm going to deepen this because I have a discussion next week about this. So I will maybe have some updates in a short time. I will let you know.
Yeah, we'll sort all this out, won't we, Viviana?
Okay, I propose to remember.
Thank you.
Arguments. So now we are in time for the second presentation, please. And after, but we have a time for discussion at the end of the three presentations, because maybe several questions will, the answer to several questions will be in the presentation that we will see now from the other speakers. So, but there are maybe other questions too. So Viviana, please share your presentation.
So because I see in the chat some other question, but we will maybe answer later. So let me know if you see, well, it's in presentation mode, it's okay. You see?
Yes. Looks good.
Okay. Yes. So yes, I'm Viviana Priar-Mattei, and I work at CMCC, that is the Euro-Mediterranean Center of Climate Change, and then I am the responsible of the Advanced Observing System Research Unit within the Global Cost Solution Division. And I will share with you some of the last technologies that we developed also through the collaboration with the University of Tucson and Nature 4 with Riccardo Valentini. Some of the last low-cost technologies that we can apply to cost-efficient observing systems. But I would like to begin with the needs and the question that we are facing in the last years, because I will try to speak about technological development, because we cannot manage what we don't measure and observe. And we look at the extreme variation that we are observing in the marine environment, and now mainly in the coastal areas, where we need more and more observing capacities and observing capabilities to look at and face these changes. And for this reason, in the Global Ocean Observing System 2030 strategy, they found that it's fundamental, the innovation in the observing technologies. And these technologies has to be used to be to be able to develop integrated, responsive, and also sustained global observing system, because the observation of the ocean and of the marine environment is essential to comprehend the impacts of climate change, but also for our safety and well-being. But like Patrick said before, also the ocean decade calls for an expansion of the global ocean observing system. And it aims also to focus on the sustainability of this global ocean observing system. So we have also additionally to reduce the technological barriers, as said before, to ensure the equitable access to observing resources for all. We spoke about the variables, about the needs of parameters to be measured, and we have the essential climate variables and the essential ocean variables that form the basis of the global climate indicators that contain all the key information for the most relevant areas of climate change. But these variables must be observed and measured, but for sure they need further standardization and more use, because they need to be more measured. And all these variables and the standardization and the improved utilization could be done by the existing sensor, the traditional one, but also by new sensor technologies. And these new sensor technologies must be developed to be suitable for multiple platforms, as, yes, from ships, moorings, but also, for example, from for autonomous platforms like gliders or autonomous system. And all this data will be useful for example, for the calibration and validation of remote sensing technologies, but as I will show you later, also for the numerical model for forecasting numerical model validation. This is true more and more in the coastal marine system, where, as you can see, uses and resources often are in conflict. The uses can be the energy industries. I show you some of the uses in the coastal areas. So energy industries, the fishery, the tourism, the maritime transport, the coastal infrastructure that often are interested by development. And so new infrastructure can be built and so can be in conflict with the natural resources, which are very important for the maintenance of the ecosystem services. And in the last years, so we have the addition of climate change effect, which can directly impact this important ecosystem. And here I show you one example of an extreme event like marine heat waves, which impacted directly on an important ecosystem that is the Posidonia Australis Medius, which after the passage of a marine heat wave was entirely destroyed. So we are seeing an increasing of both frequency and intensity of extreme events that could be related to different parameters. One of the first, for example, is for sure the temperature. And as you can see from this trend of the surface temperature, we have an increasing of 1.6 degrees since 1940. But not only the temperature, there are many other events that are going to be more and more important and are increasing their trends, like the flooding and the extreme rain events. So in this context, the need of early warning system and marine monitoring system is primary. I share with you the most recent events that we have experienced both in Italy, like in the Emilia-Romagna region, and also in the Latium region, and unfortunately in Valencia as well, where in just few hours, an entire year worth of rain fell. So we see a very extreme events and big disasters. But we have to take into account that also that the impacts of these events also can affect the marine ecosystem services and can cause the habitat loss and can modify the water chemistry. For example, it can change the nutrient availability, can change the turbidity. So, for example, Lucy spoke about the sediment transfer or the turbidity along the water column, the organic matter concentration that can affect the life in the water column and on the sea bottom. For this reason, there is a growing need for technological advancement to implement this early warning system and the marine monitoring system. However, this challenge requires a large number of sensors that has to be distributed across wide areas, and often the traditional instruments are costly and difficult to install. So low-cost sensor and citizen science initiative could greatly help address the challenge of creating observing systems distributed across both the space and time. And here I report an example of a very important low-cost and smart sensing initiative that is the Smart Sea Level Sensor Project, which is a partnership between the Emergency Management Agency, the City of Savannah, and the Georgia Tech scientists and engineers, who worked together to install a network of internet-enabled low-cost sea level sensor. And all these data that are managed in real time on coastal flooding are used for the emergency planning and response. So the issue is that sometimes we encounter this kind of mindset, like I cite. Low-cost sensor also facilitates citizen science projects, providing more localized and granular data and making environmental monitoring more accessible to communities. However, the accuracy and reliability of data generated by this sensor can be a concern, particularly without proper calibration. So the concern is related to the resolution and the reliability of data coming from low cost and citizen science initiatives. So we have to work on this also because on the other side, we have that, for example, the European Marine Board say that now more than ever, policy and research are focused on understanding the changes occurring in ocean systems. So marine citizen science the low-cost sensor has the potential not only to influence society environmental impact through education and awareness, but also to empower citizens to actively participate in developing and implementing maritime policies. So the other concern is about the publication and the data quality control and the availability of data coming from low cost and citizen science initiative and technologies. And the primary outcome of all scientific studies is the publication in peer-reviewed scientific literature. And low-cost sensor and marine citizen science are not an exception. So this could be the good process to ensure the validity of these citizens-based and low-cost approach. So in this context, I want to share with you the last development that we bring ahead in these years, based on low cost and citizen science, or low cost technologies that could be also used like citizen science technologies. These kind of technologies was really developed to expand the capabilities of marine observation. And I will start with this sea level sensor that we developed in collaboration with the University of Tushan and Nature 4. And this is a very low cost ultrasonic sensor. The sensor is very low cost. And if you look at the whole system that we can deploy in a place, we are around 200, 300 euros. The important thing is that this sensor has undergone an extensive calibration and intercomparison testing. In fact, a series of other sensor, reference sensor, both radar and ultrasonic, were compared both in laboratory tests and in situ. So we made a tank and we put together all the sensor, trying to compare them with a fixed surface where we could put the comparison. And then we deployed at the fixed station with our sensor and the comparison sensor were installed together. And in the same site, we had the reference tight gauge that was installed inside the harbor. And as you can see, there is a very good comparison between our sensor and the reference one. And we have to say that all the data are quality control and are available in real time in the physics of in the physics part of eModNet. So now an extended deployment is foreseen in the next months in different areas just to try to monitor both the sea level rise in the coastal areas, but also the river levels and the levels in the surrounding areas. So we will deploy it in the areas interested by the two biggest rivers in Italy, like the Po River in the Adriatic Sea, in the northeastern part of the Italian peninsula, and also in the Latium region, where there is the second biggest river, the Tiber River, in the Apulia region, and just a few weeks ago, also in the Apulia, in the Emilia-Romagna area, that was, as said before, interested by very extreme flooding events. So the other interesting development is related to a tank that we developed in collaboration with Nature 4. It is based on a multi-purpose low consumption electronics that we call the TT Marine, which is able to manage a lot of sensors like temperature and depth sensor. We also added the accelerometer because being a tag, we will use on animals. We are going to deploy on turtles. And so we put the accelerometer to acquire also the behavior of the animal during the tracking along the water column. And but the real new integration is the a very low cost multispectral sensor developed by Nature4. It's a very challenging sensor because it's a 26 channels low cost spectrometer that work over a range of visible and also near infrared wavelengths. It can measure the photosynthetic active radiation and the near infrared wavelengths. So as you can see, we are going to be more related to not only the physical parameters, but also the biooptical that could give us a good idea of the characteristics of the water column, because the wavelengths are related to specific particles in the water. And this kind of instrument could be very useful for the validation and the calibration of remote sensing data. So we will have a lot of data acquired by the example, for example, the turtles or other animals that will be able to give us a lot of very important marine data. For sure, the TT Marine technology also manage the transmission system, that is a satellite transmission system. Also, this will be a very new thing, because we are trying to use a not much used satellite technologies. So we don't use the Iridium, we don't use Argos. We will go to Globalstar, that is a new challenge, and we are testing, and we are having very good results. Also, in this case, a deep calibration procedure was carried out, mainly on the multispectral sensor. It was made both in the lab and in situ. In the lab, the measurements were conducted comparing our multispectral with the reference ocean optics spectrometer, and we made some experiments with different light intensity through a benchmark that we used. But we made also in situ tests, and we compare our spectrometer with the reference Atlantic OCR 507 multispectral sensor. As you can see, for many of the wavelengths we measured, we have a very good comparison. The last technology I want to share with you is the TFLAP. The TFLAP was developed in collaboration with the University of Tusha. The first technology was developed by them. We improved a lot in the last year because it was born like an expandable probe for temperature and fluorescence of chlorophyll A. Expandable means that it was born like a very low cost multiparametric probe. Then we improved it and we tried to do something of not expandable, so an expandable vertical profile. The expandable one was used for the voluntary observership program. But with the not expandable one, we could apply also for long-term application on fixed station, but also for ferry box application with some application related to the incontinuous surface monitoring for sea trout measurement. Also in this case, these data are very useful for the validation of remote sensing data. This kind of technology is based on the modularity, because this modularity allows to integrate different kind of sensor. We are working also on a very low cost conductivity sensor, and the fluorescence sensor is so modular that you can change the opticals and you can change the kind of fluorescence. So we work not only on the chlorophyll A fluorescence, but also on the sedum, the chromophoric dissolved organic matter, and the turbidity. As you know, they are very important to understand the quality of the water column and the quality of the environment. Also in this case, It was made, it was carried out a very important and big effort for the calibration of the system. You see some example for temperature and chlorophyll efflorescence. So we made a calibration both in the lab and in situ. In situ, you can see the profiles, the comparison of the profiles of temperature and chlorophyll against the seabird for temperature and Turner design for the fluorescence of the chlorophyll A. And on the right side, you can see the ferry box application where the system was put in a sailing boss, and here you can see the tracks and the data acquired on in continuous on the surface of the marine environment. But as you can see, we this low cost system, if they are modular, if they are low consumption, if they are easy to install, can be integrated in different kind of platform like this one that we call the buoy of opportunity, because it didn't burn like an oceanography buoy. It was a signaling buoy in the marine protected area of Torre Guaceto. And we equipped with this low cost system, very easy to install. And it was for a long time on board of this buoy. But the other application could be for the Lagrangian buoys, so for drifter, where we could use these technologies not only for the study of surface currents, but also for the study of the surface temperature or, for example, light parameters. The other important integration of this low-cost sensor for sure could be, and we are working on this, on cost-effective, autonomous, and experimental vehicles. Here you can see two examples of two autonomous vehicles we have at CMCC, an autonomous surface vehicle and a glider. We are working on the integration of T-flap on this kind of technology. And on the right, an experimental vehicle developed by CNR in Italy that was equipped with a T-flap to monitor extreme areas like the front of the glaciers, where we could study both the temperature and the chlorophyll, that is a very important parameter to be studied in this kind of very changing environments. So in conclusion, I can say that all the low-cost sensor and citizen science data would give a big help in the acquisition of very important data on marine and ocean environments. And all these data are very important because they could fit forecasting model like this one, that is a very high resolution operative model developed at CMCC. Operative means that every day it can forecast the 3 days after, so it needs a big amount of data to be validated and to have always more reliable results. So thank you for the attention. And
okay, thank you very interesting presentation. So there are questions regarding the presentation of Viviana.
Maybe I can just give a comment, Viviana. You're doing amazing stuff, but it's also showing the different levels that we are dealing with when we talk about this kind of technologies and citizen science. It's we're dealing from everything from pretty advanced sensors and systems that are being built to really people who are collecting data on the beach, basically, yeah. Bringing out just measuring a temperature somewhere. So it's this super wide kind of spectrum that we're looking at when we're doing this. Just a small little question. The turtles, the sensor that you put on the turtles. Once you start collecting that data, I don't know if you're already connected to Anibos, the program under GOOS. This is something we could do because yeah. you're way more advanced than many of those in yeah. Anibos with the whole data flow and everything. You could be a nice showcase to plug it into Anibos.
No, we are still in connection with them because We finished now the development. We calibrated the sensors, but we tested the system in the environment, but we never tag a turtle. So we are waiting for this, and for sure at the end of all the tests, we will do that. So I didn't cite any boss, but I know we could work with them, and it would be really amazing because we know that we could integrate something that is still missing and it's very new. So we hope it will be, because we had by nature for the opportunity to integrate this sensor. We found immediately the good application, and we hope to have very good data to be available for this. As you said, yes, there are some levels of low cost and citizen science data, because we go from a very easy kind of data acquisition to a more complex. But I think that if the system are low cost and give good data, we can make available to citizen science, and this could give very big opportunities for all to acquire data. So for example, the sea level, we will do a citizen science version, because we would like that people like the CTD, the open CTD, can do by themselves the sensor and be able to install and deploy like maybe the Savannah initiative. So the idea is that maybe all the low cost sensor must be developed also in the citizen science direction. So to be available for all people, and to be available for more and more data acquisition.
This is why it's so important that we get this marketplace there.
Yeah.
So we have these tools in a place, one place where people can go and like, you know, they can do their shopping. So it's yeah. It's good that we're working on that one.
The question from Eric. Is there a place, platform, website where we can look at your different sensors development? I'm particularly
That's spot on.
Interested in your spectrometer, simple and multi-spectra. Centralization of all these developments is probably crucial in an open science framework. In the chat.
That's exactly what we were saying here. This is what we need. I'm sure, Viviana, you have a place where you can point Eric, but we need this global kind of point where people can go and look at it. But maybe you comment, Vivi.
Yes, I am sure that in the next present, I'm sure, but I hope before to be sure that Patrick in the next presentation will show our sensors. And also, yes, for sure, and Ricardo, because we are all involved in these developments. And what Patrick made with Lancelot and Scoop is for us a new. So we will try to use this centralized portal to share with all people this kind of technology. For sure, there are some papers because we published the results of our developments in papers. For I see that you are Eric is particularly interested in the fluorometer. You can see the TFLAP. There are a lot of publications, and also in the Arctic area, you saw the experimental vehicle. We published a lot of data about the area of glacier fronts. We are going to publish the sea level sensor in the next weeks, I hope. So we are going to do this because in EmodNet you can see and download the data, but you don't see the technology. So we are As I said before, the peer review papers are very important for the reliability and the credibility of these local sensors. So we are doing this. And maybe after all this work, we will give to Patrick the availability to share with the through this portal our technologies. For the multispectral point of view, it was developed by Nature4 by Riccardo Valentini. So I think he will speak about this in the next presentation, and he will go deeper in this kind of technology. We took a technology and we applied to marine environment. So our work is marine and oceanographic application. We took something of more land technology, and we used, because it was an amazing sensor, low cost, and we tried to use in marine environment. It worked very well. And so we are going to go ahead also with this.
Yes, there is. I did a message for Juan Martinez, because I don't forget his question, but because it is a general question, I would like to make this question at the hand for all the speakers. So there is a George Petihakis from HSMR. 17, sometimes ago, the community organized the Ezonet, the yellow page point.com, but is outdated. Regarding this topic, Viviana, is a comment from George.
I don't know about this portal, this web.
Like
it's related to Fixed Point Open Ocean Observatories.
Yes.
Yes, I'm looking at this. It's involved also Jericho and EMSO. No, I didn't see. It's more related to deep sea observatories. We are more related to coastal areas. We go on open ocean, and we are also related to the water column measures. So I think that FIXO 3 is more related to mooring for deep ocean applications. I think it's... yes. About the, I don't know if Patrick, I believe the Jericho, Lucy, you can.
Yeah, Lucy, we'll let you in here, Lucy.
Well, it's an open discussion, and maybe some Jericho member or Josh, you want to take the voice, because the Jericho community really appreciated the yellow pages. And I think an update has been discussed for some time now. Maybe we will see that during the infrastructure phase of Jericho. George,
yes. Yes. So if I can add, is that this started through Ezonet, and indeed it was for fixed point observatories. But then, if you see the evolution, it was adopted by FIXO 3, again fixed point, but also by Jericho. Jericho is not fixed point; it's the coastal exactly, yeah. And it has all different platforms.
Yeah.
So the platform is there. It's up to the community whether it finds it useful to use it and update it or not. Now it has been endorsed by EMSO, I think, and Jericho. So the two communities can contribute. But as I said, the platform is there.
Yeah, we should collaborate there. I know about this one, but it's years ago I saw it. Hi, George, by the way. Good to see you there. I'll put this on my list. I got to reach out here and check it out a bit.
Okay, thank you, Viviana. I have some questions, but I prefer to leave more discussion at the hand of the third presentation. So I would like to give the chair to Ricardo. So, Mikako, please can introduce your presentation.
Okay, good morning. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for this opportunity, really. I'm here giving just a talk with some of the reflections and the lesson that we have learned by collaborating with you guys, because I am a professor, actually, of the colleague of Marco Uccelli and Gianni Vitaviviani as well, coming from more the ecology and first with the terrestrial ecosystems, monitoring and developing technologies. I am a biophysicist as a career. And then we created a startup with my students, getting together engineers and biologists, ecologists, and also recently people in marine applications are also collaborating with us. So that's at the end, in reality, the two domains are very similar. When we are talking about geosciences, we include both, you know, land and oceans, and problems are very similar, and technology is very important for us. Actually, in this moment, I think we have a very exciting time because we have, on one hand, the great capabilities coming from microprocessors, microelectronics, advanced sensors, and the AI explosion that is really in parallel. And this is why I start a little bit with a couple of reflections on how the two big streams are really parallel in this moment. They should converge more, because one need the other, you know, to provide knowledge and information. And I think we have to, in some way drive this process of combining IoT sensors and AI in a common trajectory. So then I would like to start, first of all, the name of the company is Nature 4.0. Let's just introduce a little bit the Nature 4.0. The name is a little bit advocating the industry 4.0 that we are know very well in Europe. So the big industrial transformation into, let's say, digital industry. And this is exactly what we had the inspiration to use the same technologies that are part of the industry 4.0 into the natural processes and natural ecosystems, so land and oceans. Studies. Then today we actually live in this two main streams. One is the democratization of technology that is very popular now, and is already done a lot in the past, and there's a history of how democratization took place in technology, starting from internet, of course, that was our main driving force. Then in the 80s, and then into the mobile system, mobile devices were the first, let's say, sensors, easy, handy, that citizens can use. Then small robots, automations, cloud computing is another democratization. We use a centralized computing. And then, of course, AI came to play as an additional democratization driver. But then we have another step today that is even more complex. That is the democratization of the AI going to the what we call the no-code AI. That's the main revolution that is occurring. That I, you know, if you remember, everything started on 6th of November 2023, you know, with the OpenAI big deployments, ChatGPT and so on. Large language model that now are becoming evolving into no coding. So this means that everybody basically don't need to know Python or C++ or whatever to make knowledge. This is big revolution. And so we have to ask how, you know, as a scientist and technology developers, really we can continue to develop knowledge without information, basically, but using bots or chatbots that are in the cloud. That's an intriguing question that now I think I present you the need of data because of this needs. So there is a question, is AI self-sufficient to improve knowledge? No, AI needs basically data. And this is why we are here, and we need to be very clear on this point. We cannot use AI algorithms without the data that generate AI. And, you know, this is exactly another reflection coming from how we're going to use AI in our predictions, in our understanding of processes, basically using a Bayesian approach where we try to adapt the real world to the data. Now that's what is the big revolution, that we don't have anymore a pre-ordered hypothesis, deterministic hypothesis on predictions. We just take the data and try to simulate the reality, adjusting different weights and so on, or using Bayesian approach. So, but this is a risk that if we don't have an enough knowledge of the data around us, we don't produce new knowledge. And an example of this is when, for example, we apply this Bayesian approach and we have limited that number of data, basically we enter in the Occam razor paradox. So we tend to have one solution only to our problem that is just dependent on maybe the small data set that we have taken. So we can be probably have a great probability that this event is real, but we cannot exclude that there are other solutions if we don't expand our domain of information observation. That's the main point. So there is always this contradictory aspect in AI application to get very high probability results in our predictions, but at the same time, we need to expand the observation domain to be sure that there is exactly that solution. There can be other solutions, like, for example, that's been many times discussed, the problem on local minimas and general minimas in the optimization fashion. That's exactly the point, that we need more data, and net data also acquired in different conditions in areas where we don't have yet information and so on. Then let me introduce a new concept that's emerging and it's becoming very trendy, at least for us, that we are working on this, the concept of wet AI. I mean, wet AI is exactly the interaction between data, solid data, sensors, with the artificial intelligence. Wet means that we have our hands in something that is real, not just the theoretical algorithms. So the wet part can be biotech, can be any other physical that is acquired by real sensors, something like that. That's a big revolution again, and the wet AI is our business, where we need to go for having better algorithms in the future. So IoT is one of the wet AI solutions, and as a company that is actually more a research lab connected with the university, we basically develop our domain of the technology in this area. And there are very common problems that we are sharing at all level for oceans and lands. It's first of all, the spatial scale. We need more data at high granularity. And this is fundamental, again, for developing our algorithms. So we need massive development of observation. At the same time, not only space, we need also high temporal frequency, because that was in the past a big problem when we have a very complex instruments that, making campaigns, oceanographic campaigns or land campaigns with a limited amount of time, few experiments, is not enough. We need almost continuous quasi real-time data to depict the small fluctuations, the change that can be very important for understanding our process. Feasibility, reducing cost. Cost is a particularly, if you want to expand all technology, not global regions, so including the South, as we discussed before. Then there are two things that are also becoming very important for me, and that we focus a little bit. One is the ultra low power technologies. It's maybe, guys, so for you, easy to say, okay, let's have a sensor, go around and we take data. For us that we have our hands on it, this beats energy. Energy is a big, big problem, especially if you have to work remotely for years without other source of energy than sun or wind or batteries that have a high capacity. So that's the energy sequestration is important for sensors, for measurements, as well as connectivity, okay? We want to deploy things everywhere in the world where even classic things like 4G or other connectivity is not available. And so we need to think about that this very seriously in combination with the plan. Okay, it's true that we are today in a very fantastic trend of IoT sensors moving up in the market. We today have something like 42 billions or even 50 billions. Yeah. I have to update every year my numbers. And now we are heading to 2025 to 75 billions. The growth, the billions of sensors are connected. So that's really a huge amount of numbers. And this is growing also exponentially. Then I think I want to focus on, based on our experience, we learned a lot doing things in the field, working with our colleagues in marine science. And I think there are, I think, four emerging things that I really want to like to focus for IoT applications. The first one is the edge computing, okay? We are more and more able to compact our intelligence, our algorithms into small microprocessors. And this is a great trend. So the classical way to send data to a cloud computing system and then work and receive the information is probably over, or it can be slowed down by the fact that we can have edge information at the edge. So meaning we can now have, for example, like a microprocessor, this we use a lot of SD microelectronics products, and it's a microprocessor of 8 millimeter by 8 millimeter. We can load this with PyTorch or TensorFlow algorithms for doing AI inside this, okay? Even better than, or I mean, even at less space than NVIDIA GPU. So this is really a big trend at ultra-low power, even at ultra-low power conditions. And the second big emerging thing is that connectivity. Connectivity is evolving quickly from 3G, GSM to now 4G, 5G, LTE, especially narrowband IoT that is becoming a standard for IoT communication in the domain of the LTE. So meaning in the 4G, 5G domain. But then we have also the LoRa, long range radio, that is also becoming very popular, especially in very remote areas, so that it can be transmitted by radio signals. And finally, the satellite communication that Viviana has mentioned before, the Global Star, in this case, is a Global Star board that we produce for our colleagues. And is a really very, very good. And the cost of data transmission by satellite now is very competing with even 4G and or LoRa. And we can have something like in the order of 20 euros per month or something, flat rate data transmission through satellite. That's very, very amazing. Then the low consumption is going down quickly again. There are emerging technologies that bring down now, for example, ultra low power controllers to really, really micro watts, micro pairs also. And this is, it can be done in two ways. One, because we are now able to work with reducing the clock frequency of processors. That's very important. You don't need high velocity to a simple addition or a simple algorithm. So sometimes there is an overcharging clock speed in a microprocessor that consume a lot of power. So for best of our application, we can reduce the clock. This is something we do in our algorithms, achieving very, very low consumption. And the other important part is the new batteries, the new technology batteries that is becoming very popular, from lithium battery to graphene and sodium technologies. Now we are really increasing the density of energy at unprecedented level. So you can store, or maybe something like 30, 50 ampere hour. So just to give you an idea, the car battery in something that is like 10 centimeter of dimension. So it's really a great big step. It is very important for us for remote areas. Then the fourth part of our consideration today emerging is, it was already discussed by Patrick and Viviana, and some questions, the balance between massive data that we see between citizen science and so on, and the data integrity, because it's real, in reality, the problem that in principle, AI algorithms are very good in this screen distinguish between chaotic data, noisy data, and real data. Okay, actually, they are really developed for doing that, this job. Okay, but when they, however, be generalized, need the real data to optimize their algorithms, the real data can contain itself error and mistakes, and so the outcomes can be completely wrong. So it's important that to know that the quality of data is very important for having good AI predictions. And this is why there is a big involvement now in what we call specific data lakes. People doesn't basically trust anymore in the big data lakes, like for example, ChatGPT today is using. We need a specific data lake for each domain. For ecology or for ocean or for land, we need a specific data like we know, we trust. We are able to extract useful information because it's really always true that what you put in you find out. So shit you put in, shit you put out. So that's an important evolvement. And now, for example, we got a lot of requests to produce edge computers with specific data lakes and security also control, that the algorithms are dependent on that particular data lake, and not they're not just going throughout the whole web system that could be polluted by mistakes or false or fake information. That's an important part. I will come back to that on the conclusion. And then also our databases that are today used for data gathering that are based on structural conditions, like for example SQL, are not really efficient in this type of information gathering analysis. So we need to go very quickly to non-structured database. So my comment also is to come back in the conclusion. We need to put together interoperability system for sensor and data acquisition, but also to try to evolve toward non-structured database for data analysis. Then, very briefly, to close, welcome to Nature 4.0. This is an iconic image of forest and oceans. Together, the oceans are just at the bottom of this nice path. We are key in this part of the world, in Italy, and we're very happy to collaborate with other colleagues. Actually, our startup mostly is producing services to other scientific communities, and we are very proud of it. And we are very proud because we do everything from scratch. So, for example, looking at real time data is our main effort, using microprocessing, microcomputing, sensors, and so on. What we do is to start from scratch. So basically, we design ourselves the electronics, the design, and we produce the PCB, we produce the boards. This is a very important. We started with an autarctic vision because most of the companies are in reality integrating different technologies. We think that for make a good service to our colleagues in science, we need to control completely the production line from the design of electronics to the final production. And this was very helpful during the COVID time when there was a shortage of chips in the market, and we had to, in a very short turnaround, 24 hours, change our design, build new boards, make new functionalities. And so this can be done very quickly because of this investment that we have done on a complete pipeline that we control. Then, just a few examples of what we do very quickly. We started with land, as I said before, and this is our patent. It's a tree torker, it's a device, IoT device, measuring different functions of a tree, from much water consumption, growth, leaves, colors, stability, and so on. We have now 6,000 devices transmitting data globally using our systems, and this is a community is growing in the terrestrial ecology that we are very proud to have been the initiator of that. Then we've done also atmospheric measurements, and we developed a system for measuring atmospheric gases, and last development is the CO2 photoacoustic device that we then developed that is very using a photoacoustic sensor. It is much newer than the classic electrochemical or optical sensors. Then we have a part of this, a very important link with our colleagues from oceanography, the spectroscopic development. We have developed a series of very low cost spectroscopy systems in the visible and recently also the near infrared. This was already mentioned by Viviana, is our born of the tetra spec, the tetra because it contains four spectrometers. And so you see these four little things here are the four spectrometers that are binary electronics with a total 26 plus two bands covering the visible and a little bit of a near infrared range. And this as Viviana showed, is going to be used in turtle, but also as can be used for any kind of spectroscopic measurements like turbidity in water and so on. And it's been already tested and calibrated. And it looks it's fine. It's very low cost, actually. Then we have also produced a near infrared spectrometer that is very quite low cost. Spanning the 60-50 nanometers to 1,000 nanometers with full width bands of 8 nanometers. So we are covering continuously the spectrum with 8 nanometers discrete bands. And this is based on the Fabry-Perot technology that we are also using for other applications. And these are, again, available for ocean applications, like, for example, microplastics, because in this near infrared band, the plastic can be monitored very, very nicely, or other organic molecules that are of interest. Then the technology of transmission, LoRaWAN. Okay, we have our own LoRaWAN devices. We can provide LoRaWAN to everybody who has these needs. The range of these communications. 3 to 4 kilometers in built environment. We did an experiment with Viviana and Marco using our system up to 10, 15 kilometers, but probably even more with more powerful antennas can be done in marine environments. So an interesting technology for example, coastal monitoring and data gathering. Then we treated this narrowband IoT, the 4G sideband that we heavily use also. We produce our own modem and it's worldwide. It's working again very well. And the cost is also cheap because you spend our system costs 10 euro, the SIM card, and it can run for 10 years. So it's absolutely cheap. 10 euros for 10 years is absolutely feasible. That this is the actual country that we now invest a lot is the satellite communication, the global star opportunity. These are the border that we produce for the turtles, but also for other applications that are very to say interesting because the low cost and flat rate data transmission that can open new windows, let's say in IoT application marine. Then finally, as also Viviana mentioned, we try to put together sort of we call the cyber marine. It's a new system that is general purpose, so it advanced the data logging system with several gates for different all the important sensors that actually. Viviana and Marco told me that we should be part of this system, but of course can be put many others without problems with all the possible communication systems. So you can choose between 4G, LoRa, satellite. You can use different serial communication from RS-232 to RS-485 for long distance, or USB or I2C. So basically, it's everything in there. It's very general purpose, can be put in VoIP, can be put in any device that needs to transmit data without problem. So the idea is to create an overall data logging with all capabilities, with a seamless changing of everything by software without hassles in hardware. So this is our last product that we are then I think I almost finished. The take home messages. It was very interesting, this webinar, and to have these talks from you guys. I like very much the idea that Patrick announced about the web marketplace to catalog. Is really definitely needed. There is I look from the perspective of scientists, like I am, of course, but I'm also a producer. And I see the difficulties to go around and search for what is new. I think this is a fantastic idea because having a place, at least for oceans, where we can have what is available today, what are the specifications, the costs, and so on, could be a very great service for the community. So we would like to participate. As soon as this materializes, I will be there for sure. Then we need also, I think, to you guys from the science community to get into more about the requirements and standards for sensors. It's very important. We can do everything. We can do everything, really. But we need to know what level of accuracy you require, what level, not only accuracy, but also very important, stability, range of temperatures, of operations, how many hours, how many days, years. So I mean, all the package that make real. Otherwise, everything becomes just prototyping. And this is not what we want to do, okay? We want to do real things that stay outside in harsh conditions for forever. I mean, for the time that we decide we have to be there. So if you give us more guidance, we avoid to make mistakes, because otherwise we make mistakes. We don't know exactly where we want to work. And so this requires some kind of blueprint paper, you know, to be published, something that the community can be published. Okay, what should be a real monitoring sensor for ocean that has to withstand a particular, and what kind of accuracy needs to be had. Then I think the future is satellite communications. So I think we need to really improve that part. And why not start to push the satellite companies to work for us? We need a specific environmental monitoring network for data transmission. I'm really pushing for that. I'm working for that already. I would like to set up a CubeSat system dedicated to satellite data for marine and land applications. We cannot just, you know, use Starlink way out. It's too expensive and too energy costly, and we don't need the YouTube videos, no, in our system so far. So we need more simple things, cost effective. Again, ultra low power, but we need a company, a satellite company that believes in this. Probably GlobalStar, we will see, could be one or more than one company, for sure. Then the data architecture, the platform is important. So where this data is going on into edge computing, of course, is very important, but also the architecture of the database are very important as well for AI applications. And so we need to really spend some time of interoperability, because this means interoperability in reality. So it's very important to spend some time on that. And finally, I am more and more convinced that we need to specific data lakes. So that we have to, now we can have our own AI, even chat, even large language model tailored in our data lakes. We need to create specific data lakes for our data and try to avoid, let's say, web global data systems, because they are not probably enough of quality that what we need. Okay, I finished here, and I thank all of you, and we are very happy to help everyone is interested to develop crazy things. We are here. Thank you.
Thank you, Riccardo, very much. And before, if there are several questions, but there is an old question made by Juan Francisco Martinez that is actual, and regarding the cost of maintenance of the sensors, because in a marine environment, one of the huge problems is the maintenance. We have several little problems of maintenance regarding our sensors. So how do you face, Riccardo, the maintenance of the cost of the maintenance as part of the initial cost of the device, or there is a separated plane to manage the maintenance costs? Is the question of one.
Yeah. Thank you, Marco. I think it's a great question. And we are more and more now evolving into basically not selling the hardware anymore, but selling just the service. Because why? Because, okay, traditionally you have the hardware, you have to buy the hardware, okay? And then you buy maybe a contract for operations, okay? But the two things are not working properly, because you don't know when you have to do maintenance. So the two communities, the seller does know exactly what you are doing with your sensor, okay? So I think the solution is to have something that you have a service that we take care of everything, take care of maintenance, we take care of substitution, take care, because we know the lifetime, we know what are the problems, and so you pay a fee for maintaining your operational network. I think this is the, at least most of the, a lot of people asking us to do this way. To combine a cost that is for per year cost of monitoring.
Okay, thank you, Riccardo. I have a question for all the you, if you permit my inclusion now, that is a question that I have for the first presentation to Viviana, up to you, Riccardo. The question is, what do you, one of the problems both for Patrick, Viviana, and you, Riccardo, is regarding the calibration and accuracy and stability of the data. So for you, or you, what is the best way, a calibration, an inter-calibration program to establish the protocols? Because I try clearly, developer, so I try to a lot of different, for example, temperature sensors, and are not the same results, are not the same quality, are not the same stability. So which kind of idea to select the components to realize an intercalibration program, to realize an intercalibration site with several institutions that can do the test, to understand which are the best protocols for all the people to understand if their sensors are okay. And so it's a big program for me. Who wants to answer? Can start.
Thanks for the question. I think that first of all, again, requirements are important, and this is the science community has the final word to set what is needed, what is needed in terms of accuracy. Okay, and so this is sometimes not clear, you know, and in some cases. You don't need the high accuracy, depending on your goal. And of course, the cost and everything is related to accuracy, for example. And I think we need really to clarify what is the meaning of accuracy in our work. And accuracy can be defined. It's a responsibility of the producer to expose the accuracy, okay, based on laboratory conditions and also field operations. Also, that's everything. So I start from that. Of course, the question of complex variables that are the combination of let's say individual sensors, no, individual physical measurements, but they combine something that, for example, fluorescence signal, okay. That is different, and the fluorescence has to be probably this type of aggregated measure should be probably best approached with either comparison campaign or certified or labs where this can be done. Why not to create a certified lab for ocean technology or something like that, where people work for the community to test particularly this complex variable data.
Thank you. Other questions? We have just a few minutes. Then I conclude this. Thank you for your fascinating point of view, Ricardo, mainly regarding the non-structured database, because I think it's a question that we will go in deep in the next webinar, I hope. There are other questions? Just Patrick, Diana, Manfred, no questions?
No comments. No. And 3 minutes left. Well, I don't dare to open my mouth again.
Okay, thank you.
Well, thanks, Marco, as well. Thank you very much for organizing this webinar. Thank you to the speakers as well.
Yes.
Thank you, Lassie. So I conclude, we have today just 20 seconds. I thank you to all the speakers, all the person that are with us today. It's a very important topics for me and also for the scientific community. And thanks. We learned three different presentations of our different actors in different fields to they face the same problem from different perspectives. So now I leave the chair to Lucie for the conclusion and for next communication, just in time.
Thank you very much. I'm Lucie Cocampo. I co-chair the EuroGOOS Scientific Advisory Working Group. And this group of 20-something people aims to explore and document the new scientific orientation for work in ocean observation and operational oceanography. So we've just initiated this series of webinars. Thank you for being the first. It was very successful. thanks to the audience and to all the speakers. And the goal is to threaten the links between EuroGOOS organization and the community in order to build the future together somehow. So I wonder what would be the next step for this low-tech webinar. Can we keep the emails of the participants and the audience in order to have a mailing list and maybe to distribute some information? Would people be interested in taking part in surveys? Or maybe I think it would be great if we could produce a white paper. So if we have some volunteers within the speakers and the audience, people that would like to write this white paper together, we would be more than happy to do so. And we'll definitely stay in touch. This is the first webinar of a long series. The next one will be on artificial intelligence and machine learning for operational oceanography. So we'll keep you updated about the date. But for this low-cost subject, we will be very happy to produce some outcome of this discussion. And we will very much welcome all the volunteers that would like to take part of this adventure. And I think that was the conclusion. We'll definitely stay in touch via emails with concrete actions.
Thank you, Lucille.
Thank you.
We are finished, Joseph. We conclude now the webinar. It's time, perfectly, time. Also, if we cut the general discussion, thank you to all, and we can leave this webinar session. Bye, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thanks,
everybody. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.